This talk is Grantsmanship Mechanics. It's intended as an overview of what NIH grants consist of and the kinds of things you want to keep in mind as you're going through this. The biosketch. The purpose, your purpose for your biosketch and for everybody else's biosketch on your grant is to convince the reviewers that the key personnel needed to do the work are on the grant and they have a track record of publishing in the area and that they are important to the work being proposed. That's what it's supposed to accomplish. Okay? They just changed the format. The new format will be required in the next round of reviews that are coming up in June. Okay? And I just as a heads up, if you're writing an F grant, the requirements are somewhat different for F grant, so again, check the instructions. Okay. So, a couple of components that are, this is relatively new to a biosketch. So this changed in 2010. So you might see some examples floating around in your department that are older than that don't have it. But I can tell you that the purpose of it is to establish why you are qualified to do the work you're proposing. That's what it's supposed to do. Okay? And you can also use it to document that you've been collaborating with other people who are listed on your grant, that this is not your first rodeo, and that you can get along and work together. Keep it brief. Do not recapitulate other components of the grant here. Okay? Because I've read them in the abstracts, I've read them in the aims. I actually read the biosketch after I read the grant, so I know whether or not these people are a good fit to it. I've read them in the rest of the grant. And when I see the first page of the biosketch, which is a full page of text, starting with how they discovered their interest in the field and wandering up to the present date, or the first two paragraphs recapitulate the goals and approach of the grant, and then they finally tucked in there is why they're well-suited to do this work, I think, oh, my God, are you going to make me take a pair of tweezers and pry the relevant stuff out of here, you know, again, at 10 at night? So don't do that. All you're supposed to do is tell us why you're the person who should do this work. So here's my bio sketch I've used for grants that get funded. You see how long it is? That's it. So I say, here's what I know how to do. I've been working with these people. We've done these past things together. And that's why I can do the work I'm proposing to do. Okay. Then there's a section on position and honors that's in the instructions, very clear. New this year are sections on contribution to science. And I can't tell you concrete tips about this because, frankly, the review committees haven't seen them yet. But I can anticipate what people are going to think. Okay? So there is an example on the NIH web section about what kind of information they're looking for in this section. And I've given you a mock-up of what mine will look like. So follow the instructions. Keep it succinct, okay? Again, we're talking probably about a paragraph per section, dollar a word. Highlight the significance and innovation of your work. This is a nice opportunity to do that. Highlight the work that relates to the grant you're proposing, okay? So make it really clear that you have expertise in the area you're proposing to work in. Have someone else read it for tone. So two problems I'm anticipating are ones that have an overly bragging quality to them or ones that are overly modest, where the impact doesn't come through. There might be impact there, but you're not selling it. But you don't want to sell it too much, okay? So have somebody else read this for tone, okay? Then you also now need to include a URL to a full list of your publications. So that could be your website if you have one that you keep up. I sadly don't have one that I have one, I just don't keep it up. But the NIH also offers a format that's linked to PubMed that will automatically populate your new pubs. And I did go to that site and it is relatively easy to populate. Okay. So here's a mock-up of what it's supposed to look like. So you can see a paragraph. Then you give up to four relevant publications. There's another paragraph on another area of science I may have contributed to, up to four relevant publications related to that. And then you can do three of these, up to three. Now, yeah. Yes, yeah. So if you have developed software, you could provide a link to the software, or if you have a patent in the area, you can provide that information. Yeah. Yeah. What I would be careful about is providing things like talks, ASHA leader publications, things that are, if it's a publication, is not peer-reviewed, letters to mom, yeah. I would avoid things that are not peer-reviewed in some way. You absolutely don't want to look like you're trying to pad things out by including things that wouldn't stand up to scientific muster. Yeah. Well, yeah, no, that occurred to me as soon as I saw this, that it's much easier for me to come up with three areas of major contribution to science and four publications that relate to each than it is for somebody coming out of the gate. But on the other hand, bear in mind that NIH has a number of grant mechanisms designed for junior-level people. And I don't think I would expect to see three for a junior-level person because I would think, well, why do they need a K award if they've already made three major contributions to science, you know? So I wouldn't worry about that so much. But I think what you do want to give some time to think about is this really means that your research must be programmatic in order to pull this off. And you need to think about that up front. Cynthia, you were going to say something? Yeah. Yeah, I was going to say, I don't think I could come up with five. I have 100 publications plus, and I don't think I could come up with five. So, yeah. Yes, they don't fund individual experiments. They fund programmatic research. So here's the rest of it. You can see there's the URL to your full list of publications. Here's your relevant support. The major mistake I see from junior people here is they put grants here that funded them as a research assistant. Okay? If the grant was not in your name or you were not a co-investigator on that grant, it's not your grant. So I see junior people putting down, you know, under their relevant support, T32 grant. And I'm like, I'm sorry. Nobody awarded you a T32 grant. Nobody did that. So it's grants that were awarded to you as a PI or co-investigator. Okay. So it does include F awards because that was awarded to you. Okay, add consultants when you're new to an area or to fill out the area of their expertise. Make sure their bio sketch actually warrants their role, because over my career, I have met quite a few people who talk a good game, and then when I got their bio sketch, I was like, oh, no, this is not going to work. They haven't published anything in 10 years. You know, that's not going to fly. So make sure that the bio sketch you know, we don't know these people personally, so make sure their bio sketch represents the level of expertise you need them to do. Do not pad. And I said that. Number of your publications? Yeah. It really depends on the nature of the work you're proposing, and also, you know, one science article kind of trumps three other articles, so there's no good answer to that. But I would say if I don't see minimally one article per year of funding, I'm going to be a little bit suspicious. I mean, I can envision a situation where that would not necessarily happen, particularly with a longitudinal study. You know, that would kind of be, as a reviewer, my bare minimum of what I would expect. Bill?
Interesting point, because different people have different opinions. So I can't tell you how many times I've been in a study section, someone said, well, there are 13 publications, but only three of them is he first author, or she's first author. And I say, I don't care. There are 13 publications. That's a lot.
Yeah.
But I don't always win that argument. or there are a lot of students on these papers. Well, good. So, you know, it is tough. I don't have a magic number except to say zero is not good. And if your research is of the type that it's not going to produce lots of, like, I can only run one subject at a time for a short period of time because I spin them, okay, then put that someplace.
Yeah. Yeah, so basically help the reviewer understand the context. But also, this is a really good area to get some mentoring from somebody else who submits to the panel your grant is likely to go to, because over time, those panels develop a culture, and it depends, that is very much influenced by the fields that the panel is composed of. And so having some mentoring about what the expectations are for that panel might be very helpful.
What I've noticed, and this is just strictly anecdotal, is that, like, if the reviewers were excited about the proposal, then, you know, just give them enough ammunition so that they can defend that you're the right person to do it. If they don't like it, then I get comments like what I had with what Bill just said. So it doesn't really seem to be dependent on the number of publications directly. It really seems to be more on the general enthusiasm for the proposal.
Yeah. Yeah, you absolutely have to get the reviewers excited about your work. And if you,
just want to say one more thing about that. I think the number of publications is most important when you're doing a continuation. Okay. So if you get an R01 and then you go in for a second round of your R01, you really, really need to have publications that reflect productivity during that period. Again, there's no magic number, but the reviewers are really looking for things that reflect the actual work that they supported.
I have a quick question about preliminary data and pilot data in that section. So, for example, most of my previous publications are in animal work, and so I'm now switching over and doing neural imaging techniques in people. And so I don't have publications on my CV yet, but I have plenty of data proving that it can be done, and specifically with this project. So I was just wondering your thoughts as a reviewer of how that appears to the panel as somebody that maybe doesn't have publications in the area, but I've demonstrated that I can do the work.
Yeah, I would strongly encourage you to get the stuff in the pipeline in press before the grant goes in, because lots of people can play around, but if you can publish it, that's a different level. And so that goes back to the very first slides, is that before you even start putting your fingers to the keyboards, think about what has to get out of your pipeline to position the grant optimally.
This is a perfect place, I think, for a new or more seasoned investigator to find a collaborator. If you don't have the published work and this is what you really envision as the gap that needs to be filled, that's another really great strategy for handling that problem.
I just want to get back to the biosketch for a minute. So if you have collaborators or someone you're working with and they have to submit their biosketches, it's really important in that first paragraph for them to say what they're going to contribute to your project. So I read proposals all the time where the person's talking about their own work, but I don't know how it's going to relate to what you in particular. And so you as a new investigator, I think you can't be afraid to go back to these people and say, can I alter this for you, or will you be willing to put in something about what your specific contribution to my project is?
Okay. I write them. As the PI, I write them. I do. I just write them for my colleagues, and that way I know what the gist of the whole looks like.